You briefly talk about physiological formatting. If you could talk in detail about the physiological transformation that can happen through Sanskrit, maybe a bit about sound therapy, and also if you could share some of the transformative experiences.
Again, I would say that this language, because it impacts us, it is sound at the end of the day, and it would therefore have an impact at all the levels of our being, like any sound does. So if you listen to some music, you know, you feel heavy and sad. If you listen to other music, you feel excited. Some other music, kinds of music make you feel peaceful.
Yeah.
So we have also forgotten that languages do this in a very major way, not just language in terms of the meaning that they convey. Because I had started this when I was answering your first question, but didn't conclude on it. The fact is that languages usually have meanings attributed to words.
Mm.
But the words themselves have a song quality, and therefore the words themselves can release an experience. Sanskrit, especially the mantric Sanskrit, captures that direct connection between the experiential quality of the sound and the meaning that is given to the word based on the experiential quality, not a mentalized meaning imposed on it. All right. And so when you were asking me about the healing nature of this language, so I think one of the first aspects of this language is the fact that we breathe and therefore we are. You stop breathing and you are not. So breath is, again, foundational to our very existence. And yet we seldom think about our breath. Then you have techniques like pranayama and all that, you know, wake us up to the reality that unless you are taking care of your breath, you are not really looking after the way your body, the everything is working in your body. So breathing is very closely associated with the very flow of pranic energy in our system. And that pranic flow is good physiologically. That the way the prana flows is also directly connected to our emotional world. And there's a lot of experiments that have got that have been conducted to show that when there are certain breathing patterns, it gives rise to certain emotions. And conversely, they made people experience those emotions and they reflected the same breathing patterns. So breath and emotions are closely tied. Breath and our thinking also is very closely tied. So if we have a very short breath, we would not be able to think so clearly as if you breathe more slowly, etc. Okay, it's quite fascinating about, you know, if you look at the system as you're where there are different parts and then you have this prana, the wind that blows there. And if you have a storm that is brewing inside, if you have a storm that's brewing in an external system, the signal is always poor. So if you have a pranic storm inside the system, the signal will be poor. And that signal at various fronts. All right. So in the Sanskrit language, the breath is incorporated into the very sounds of the language. So you have the mahaprana. So I was also discussing this with a friend, and then you realize the extent to which you have to pay attention. So every single sound that you utter in Sanskrit, you have to take into account a few things. You have to take into account the place of pronunciation. You have to take into account the breath, the quantity of breath you're putting into it. And you have to take into account the duration of the vowel. If you mess up with any of this, you're not speaking Sanskrit, basically.
Yeah.
So Sanskrit really demanded you to be paying this 100% attention with every single sound you're making.
You're there all the time.
You have to be there all the time, yeah. Otherwise, it is not Sanskritam. And therefore, the name of the language, Sanskritam, it is that samyak karoti, it is that which perfects our system. It was so perfect in every aspect of its manifestation, they couldn't call it anything else. Can you think of any other language that has a name that is just describing the function of the language itself? So, and in what ways does it perfect us? The fact that we are using the breath spontaneously. So when you do ka, ka, ga, gha, ma, cha, 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 nya. So the moment that you're taking the breath into consideration, it is like an automatic pranayama. You're doing spontaneous kapalabhati or you're doing spontaneous so many other pranayamas automatically. And that natural taking into account the breath is one important reason why it can be physically beneficial to us. The second reason it can be physically beneficial is because, unlike in various languages, various non-Sanskrit based languages, the way in which the letters have been arranged in the vocal system is a very systematic touch of the different parts of the human vocal system. So you have the gutturals, ka kha ga ga nga, cha cha da da nya, ta ta da da na, you know, so cha cha da da nya, the palatals, ta ta da da na, the cerebrals, ta ta da da na, the dentals, pa 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 ma, the labials. So when you are saying the alphabet, you're doing a very systematic touch of all the different parts of your vocal system, which means that all those parts in the brain are being stimulated. You see, the speech mechanism is also closely linked to a brain part, and then the brain to the body. So those parts are stimulated in the brain, those parts will also be stimulated in the body. You see, now why do I say that Sanskrit is special? Because if you speak a language like English only, or if you only spoke, let's say French, in English you have, you know, it's like the sound T is somewhere there. You don't have a T and you don't have a T. So if you have chers and then you have a T. So this region is never stimulated physiologically if you only spoke English. Similarly, if you only spoke French, it is a T. So this entire region is never physiologically stimulated. Can you imagine that? Or even some Sanskrit derived language like Bengali, you don't have the V. So this region would never get stimulated physiologically. And the lack of stimulation has a certain effect on the body as well. And so the benefit of speaking this language. All right. And I'm, in fact, very interestingly, I met a friend in Malta, this very Christian island country in Europe. And she was studying Sanskrit in the, you know, Maltese university, where you have a professor, Michael Zamit, who teaches Sanskrit there. So it's just mind blowing, you know, the reaches of Sanskrit in the world. So she was telling me, she says that when I speak other languages, I, you know, have a nice experience. The language is good, but when I speak English, it feels as if my whole being is, when I speak Sanskrit, sorry, I feel as if my whole being is participating in this language. And I attended a camp once. In fact, I was attending various Sanskrit camps for a whole month. So I had a complete Sanskrit immersion. And then I went to a camp where I had to speak in English. And when I spoke English after being intensely immersed in Sanskrit for a month, it was as if English was, you know, coming out from the tip of my mouth or the tip of the tongue. This is not to denigrate any language, but just to recognize the fact or to appreciate the fact that the sounds of a language have their impact on the body. So this was just from a physiological. So from a physiological point, the place of touch in your vocal system, which creates the touch in your brain, which creates an effect on the body. And therefore, this is like a brain massage, I say. All right. And that has various benefits. Yeah. The other one is the breath component. So it regulates your breath automatically. It is like a spontaneous pranayama. And therefore, the emotional being is positively impacted potentially. If you say certain kinds of chants, etc., automatically it would have a specific effect within the being. And then you have, of course, the mental component of this language, where, because the mind and body are closely related again, so if the mind is always engaged in positive things, in things that are larger than itself, there are greater chances that the body will also keep well. But another last important thing about this, about the sounds board, that the different letters of the Sanskrit alphabet are associated with the different chakras. So that's going into the energy body of our being. Okay. Since every letter corresponds to a different chakra, speaking Sanskrit or chanting mantras is actually chakra circuiting, which means it's a kind of an energy circuiting. And that also has its beneficial effects, because mantras are nothing more than systematized sound technology. In terms of the mechanism, in terms of the way the prana is utilized, and you were asking me of people who have benefited from it. So I know, for example, in a workshop of mine, there was a lady who was undergoing, radiation therapy. She had just had her chemo, etc. And she came to me and she says, you know, I'm not being able to sleep. And we were doing mantra workshops, and we were doing very simple chants, not even something very elaborate. She came back the next day. She says that, you won't believe it, I slept like a baby. This was after doing 2 hours of just simple chants. She says, I've slept like a baby. Another friend of mine also, who was suffering from cancer, she said that when I say the Sanskrit alphabet, I experience as if, you know, there's a whole movement up and down my column of energy. Then you have much more, I mean, very eminent singers, Pandit Ajay Chakraborty, who has suffered a paralytic stroke. And this is something that I heard and about him. So it seems that he attributes his complete recovery. One of the reasons is the regular chanting of the mantras, the chants that he sings. So all of these aspects of the Sanskrit language can be extremely healing. In fact, one last thing I would like to, maybe two more things I'd like to add here. One is that they say that just reciting the Sanskrit alphabet, there is a Buddhist practice that if you just recite the Sanskrit alphabet, then it's a way of keeping good health. And again, you connect it to the chakras, you connect it to the brain massage factor, and you start figuring it out, you know, as to why this could be a possible reality. And the other thing in terms of speech therapies, people who have difficulty with speech, I know not just speech, but I also know of a friend who suffered from dyslexia. He was an Australian friend who suffered from dyslexia. And he says that it's after studying Sanskrit that his challenge with dyslexia disappeared. And why? Because every sound corresponds to a specific letter. So that association for the brain, that confidence of the brain that I know what I'm saying and there is no other way that this is going to change, also helps to build a self-confidence, which then can be transposed on different languages. Whereas if you study, let's say, English or French or languages, where there is no direct connection between the visual and the usual sound attributed to the letter and the sound combination in words, the combination of the letters in words, then it can lead to confusion in the mind. Why is once D-O-R door and the other time O-R is poor? You know, unless you are completely in that cultural milieu, trying to get somebody to understand this is very, very difficult. This logic is very hard to explain. But with Sanskrit, every letter corresponds to a certain sound. And therefore, and to a certain, so the way you read it, the way you write it, and the way you speak it are all the same. So that's why spoken Sanskrit, you speak Sanskrit, and all of it is in place. You have many, many things done by that, including health benefits, emotional benefits, and mental benefits, like we saw.
I mean, the more, no, sorry, you were saying something.
No, please continue, I can go on.
And I can go on listening, because the more you listen about the language, you realize it indeed is Sanskritam. So we are sitting on a treasure. Sanskrit is a treasure for India, that is Bharat. And the new education policy 2020 recognizes that, along with the other regional Indian languages, which it is going to promote. So if you could talk about the significance of this recognition that Sanskrit gets in the new education policy.
I'm like always for Sanskrit being made the language of education for just ever so many reasons, I think if we taught our youngsters, if we right from a very young age, trained our children in studying Sanskrit, this language would help to format their mind into what I say, it's an operating system without viruses. You know, so from a very young age, language formats our thinking, language formats our mind. Different languages format our minds differently. And the reason why classical languages were taught in earlier times in school systems was not just because it would give access to content that was available in classical languages, but these languages had a very systematized grammatical structure. And learning that grammatical structure also results in systematizing the brain and the way the mind functions. So if we could get children to study Sanskrit in a very natural, fun way, not the grammar to, you know, ratto maro way that they are taught today, but in a real fun, way that they can apply to dramas, write songs and all with it, then children would be, you know, enthused about the beauty, about the structure of this language. And can you imagine what it would do? Like a lot of our social problems would be spontaneously addressed, because a lot of the challenges of hierarchy that exist within the system are sometimes, I won't say always, but sometimes they have over historically been associated with access to knowledge, access to the scriptures. I'll just roll out a few benefits because I'm in the flow right now. So
yes.
Let me do it. All right. So one is, it would help just as an individual, for the individual, it would structure your mind. It would make your mind more rational in many ways. It would potentially, okay, there are irrational Sanskritists, that's a different story. but it would help to bring in a rational structure in the brain. It would help to fine-tune your hearing and speech mechanism, because you become clearer. The specifications of the sound become, you tune in to the precision of sound production and sound hearing. All right, so that's from a sound perspective. Then in terms of the language and what it can do to the regional languages, Sanskrit being the mother of all regional languages, it would nourish all the regional languages with the rich vocabulary it has. What I heard is that they're building a, you know, they're putting together a dictionary for the last 50, 60 years in Pune, and they have only reached the letter A, and it's more than 90,000 words, you know. So the vocabulary in every single domain of life exists. We would empower our youth to have access to the scientific, rich scientific heritage that is there. At least 4 to 30 million texts are languishing undeciphered, of which at least 10% is pure scientific texts, which are being deciphered by research scholars from different lands. And that is being repackaged and fed to us. So if we knew what this land, what we were as Bharatiyas, what was this Bharatam, what was this Bha all about, what was all this knowledge in different fields all about, it would offer us completely alternative ways of looking at ourselves. We have got reduced by the paradigms of knowledge that we can access. So if we were familiar, if we were acquainted with Sanskrit from a very young age, we would have the doors of our own treasure trove would open for us, for anybody, without any consideration of which class of society you belong to, what age group you have, nothing, or which region you belong to. Everybody would be, if I may say, in a real sense of Bharatiya. And the possessing Sanskrit as a tool would also act as the Sanskritization of our being. And we would not only know Sanskrit, the chances of us being Sanskrita is also enhanced by that.
It's so amazing the way you say Sanskritization of our being. And I mean, to me, it is, and with all that you've said, it's such an empowering thought. One final question. What does Sanskrit mean to you personally?
So I think it had come to me very clearly once. The Sanskrit has the spontaneous benefits of tuning us to ourselves, our deeper selves. So when you ask me what Sanskrit means to me, yeah, I think Sanskrit is in many ways my life. I would, in fact, when I had a choice to choose what I wanted to do in life after my graduation from the Sri Aurobindo Ashram in Pondicherry, Sri Aurobindo International Center of Education, I was in many minds. I mean, I had various options before me. And there was this verse from the Panchatantra and a quote from Sri Aurobindo that clinched the issue for me. So the verse said, Praptavyam artham labhate manushyaha, that the money you have to get, you will get. Devo pitam langhaitum na shaktaha, even the gods cannot change that. Tasmat na shochami na vismayome, that's why I cannot, I don't worry nor am I over excited or am, you know, wonderstruck. Yadasmadiyam nahi tat paresham, what is mine cannot be anybody else's. So I decided if that was the case, then I might as well dedicate my life to something that I'm passionate about. Because if money had to come, it would be a double whammy for me. And if money was not there, at least I would have done my life studying something that I'm deeply convinced about, its beauty and its power. And Sri Aurobindo has this quotation about the Vedas, which for me was the final, you know, the final point, where he says that the recovery of the perfect truth of the Vedas is not merely a desideratum of modern intellectual curiosity, but a practical necessity for the future of human race. And that knowledge can be accessed very directly through Sanskrit, also directly through one's own personal quest, a yogic quest. Talking about the yogas, again, there is extensive documentation of the journey. There are several roadmaps available in the Sanskrit language. So again, we see why Sanskrit is important. So, yeah, Sanskrit is a gold mine, and it is a secret of forever, you know, for ever youthfulness, if I may say, because there is just so much of wow factor about it. So I think, yeah.
No, I'm totally convinced. I look at you and I can see the benefits. I mean, I'm fangirling right now. This is not for effect. It's the truth.
The last, there are people who say, you know, because I know quite a few languages, about 7 to in about 10 around, you know. And when people say, how do you do it? So I said, Sanskritam. Sanskritam is, for me, the reason what, for the reason why I have been able to pick up different languages, the sounds of languages, the grammar of different languages. So Sanskritam is the source, Sanskritam is the way, and Sanskritam is the destination. Sanskritization is the destination, I would say, in different ways. Oh, there's so much to keep saying about Sanskrit.
Yeah. There's just so much to absorb and reflect, and I'm sure our viewers have had the same experience that I have had. Thank you so much for agreeing to do this. And I'm so glad this conversation finally happened, Anuradhaji. Thank you so much.
Satya. So can I end with two things here?
Yes, please.
So one is that I'd like to just chant a mantra from the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, which summarizes a little bit of everything that we have been talking about. And also it represents the essential quest of the Bharatiya Samskriti. So it is Om Asatoma Sadgamaya Tamasoma Jyotirgamaya Mrityorma Amritangamaya Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. So the term asataha means falsehood or untruth, and sat is truth. So asato ma sadgamaya, the usual translation is lead me from untruth to truth. Tamaso ma jyotirgamaya, lead me from darkness to light. Mrityorma amritangamaya, lead me from death to immortality. But the beauty of knowing the language is that you get another very unique shade of this particular aspiration reflected in the mantra, which is when you say asataha, it can either mean from untruth or it can mean of untruth. And the whole verse becomes, lead me to the truth of the untruth. Lead me to the light of the darkness. Lead me to the death of immortality. Om, peace, peace, peace. And just a small grammatical difference actually has a huge impact on the potential of experience that it offers. Because when you say, take me from this to that, you have a duality that is present. You're trying to say, these are all not right, let me go to this which is right. Okay. But when you say, take me to the truth of the untruth, it means every negativity harbors within it the deeper truth or the positive entity. So how can I go to the truth of the false? Nobody can lie if they don't know what the truth is. Darkness in itself, in the Shastras, doesn't have an independent reality. Darkness is the absence of light. And death can exist only if there is light, life. Only if there's eternal life, death has a partial reality. So it seems like an absolute, but coming from the integral yoga philosophy of Mother and Sri Aurobindo, even death is a partial reality. So the aspiration is, how do we touch the underlying truth structures of creation itself? And where does the language become important to understand the grammar? But also because a mantra is nothing but systematized sound power, a sound technology, the very utterance of this mantra with an open spirit, without any interference of our, you know, mentalized attributions to things and expectations, the very utterance of the sound has the potential of leading us back to that original experience. And so, Sanskritam Patantu, Sanskritam Vadantu, Jayatu Sanskritam, Jayatu Bharatam.
Jayatu Sanskritam, Jayatu Bharatam. It has been a pleasure bringing this first episode of India That Is Bharat to you. Keep watching New India Junction.